Watch these two animations and see if you can spot the biggest difference between the two. On the right, I've added some very subtle details to the limb that create the illusion of depth. By curving any horizontal lines like the cuffs of the pants or the end of the shirt sleeve, I can create the feeling that these limbs are extending either toward or away from the camera depending on which way those lines curve. Adding these little details can, in my opinion, help to elevate otherwise flat looking animations and just generally helps to create more interesting looking characters than what we're used to seeing coming out of After Effects, which is notorious for flat looking character style. And now I know what you're probably thinking, this looks like a lot of work because you gotta do it for every single limb. Maybe you'll just stick with flat, boring characters that everybody else is doing. But watch this, as I grab this limb and I move it around the composition, those little details that I added are responsive to the movement of the limb. So how do I make a limb that is responsive like this? That is what this video is about. And here's a little bit of awesome news. No matter what character tool you're using, whether that be Duik or Rubber Hose or Limber or DK tool, you can pull this off. So the big question is, what is this sorcery? Well, the secret sauce behind this little magic trick is a criminally underappreciated tool that comes as part of Duik. So yes, even if you are using one of these other tools for your characters, you will need to install Duik. Luckily, Duik is available to download for free. I've left a link in the description for your convenience. You can go grab Duik. Now, I'm using Limber in conjunction with Duik to set this all up. But no matter what tool you're using, the setup process should generally be the same. So first, I want to start by just quickly reviewing in basic terms how the connector works. The connector, in the simplest way I can explain it, is it allows us to drive the animation between two different keyframes with a property. Normally, the animation between two different keyframes is driven by time, right? You put a keyframe on frame one, you put a keyframe on frame 60, and you hit play and your animation happens. But with the connector, we can actually set it up so that we can drive the animation between these two keyframes with a property like the rotation of this triangle instead of time. So as I rotate this triangle back and forth, this square will scale up and down, but when I hit my spacebar to preview my timeline, nothing happens. And because these keyframes are connected to the rotation and not time, we can actually just scoot these two keyframes to the first and second frame of our composition to stay organized. So that is the basic function of the connector, to control the animation of a series of keyframes with a property of our choosing. Oh, and by the way, if you're enjoying the video so far, do me a favor and hit that like button to help me defeat the YouTube algorithm. Okay, so let's go back to my original limb here so that I can give you a rundown of how I'm using the connector to make this all responsive, and then I'll walk you through how to set it up. So this setup is really quite simple. I've essentially just created two little ovals right at the cuff of my pants, and one is black and the other matches the color of my pants. The scale of each oval is connected to the rotation of the knee. So depending on which way my knee rotates will determine which oval will scale up. If the knee rotates to the right, the green oval will scale up. If the knee rotates to the left, the black oval will scale up. Now, if I turn the visibility of my other groups back on so you can see the whole limb, you can see how just adding these ovals at the end of my pant cuff totally sells this effect. And it's all responsive because I've just tied everything to the rotation of the knee joint. Now, let's walk through how to set this all up. The first step whenever setting this up is to determine which property you want to use to drive the animation of these keyframes. In my case, I chose the rotation of the knee to drive everything. I chose the knee for two reasons. One, with Limber, I can create a controller for the knee and set it to rotate with the lower part of my limb. Second, this gives me a reliable rotation property that can be used to drive the perspective of my limb. Also, if you're wondering how I made this limb, you can go watch last week's video where I go over how I created this limb using Limber Lite, which is the free version of Limber. I'll leave a link to that video in the description. Since everything is going to be driven by the rotation of the knee, I'm going to select the rotation of the knee, and then I'm gonna go over to Duix Connector, open it up by clicking this little thing on the side here, and click Property. And that will load that rotation property into Duix. You'll know you loaded it correctly because it will say right underneath the name of the layer and the property that's loaded in. Also, the minimum and maximum values will be in degrees because it's a rotation. These values correlate with the keyframes on the properties we will connect up. The minimum corresponds with the first keyframe and the maximum corresponds with the second keyframe. By default, it is set to 0 and 100, but we're gonna be changing that up a little bit. Right now, the knee is at 0 degrees rotation, so we don't have to change the minimum, but we need to figure out which value to use for the maximum. I'll grab my ankle controller and I'll move it out as far as I think it needs to go, then I'll change the maximum value in the connector to correspond to the rotation value on my knee. Since my cuff is already where I want it to be out in this position, I'll start by going to the second frame because this corresponds with the maximum value, and I'll create keyframes on all the necessary properties. In my case, I'll just create keyframes on the cuff and the leg. Then I'll step back to the first frame and I'll move my ankle back so that my leg is facing straight down. In this position, I need to adjust the cuff so that it is straight. I'll open the cuff and change the trim path start and end to 50%, which will make it disappear. Then I'll make sure that the leg butts up against the cuff like so. Okay, let's review what we have so far. On frame one, the cuff is closed and flat, and on frame two, the cuff is open. Currently, time is still driving these keyframes, as you can see, as I switch back and forth between frame one and two, but not for long. To connect these keyframes to the knee, just select all the keyframes and go to Duix and hit Connect Properties. Once Duix is finished working its magic, the keyframes are no longer driven by time, but they're driven now by the rotation of the knee. As I move the ankle to the left, the leg will appear to be extending towards the camera. Now we're nearly done, but we need to create the opposite effect as the leg bends to the right. Luckily, most of the work is already done. We just need to modify it a little bit. So I'll duplicate the cuff opening and move it on top of everything. We'll need to connect the keyframes on this new cuff to a different set of minimum and maximum values. So I'll remove the expressions by holding Alt and clicking on the stopwatches on all the keyframe properties. Next, I'll change the color of this cuff to match my pants. Over in the connector, I'll change the maximum value to the negative value of whatever is already there. Now we are ready to connect everything up. And that is it. Everything is connected up and responsive to the movement of the leg. From here, you can animate your character just like you normally would, but with more depth and perspective. So as you can tell, the connector is an incredibly useful tool, and this is just one of the many ways I've utilized the connector in my own character animations. The applications of the connector are seriously endless. This shoe is another great example. I connected the shape paths animation to the rotation of the shoe. So as I rotate the shoe back and forth, the shape of the shoe shifts responsively. So anyway, that's all I have for today's video. I hope you liked it. I hope you learned something new. Thank you for joining and making it this far in the video. If you like this video, make sure you hit that like button and help me battle it out with the YouTube algorithm. If you want more content like this in the future, make sure that you are subscribed with that bell notification turned on, and we'll see you guys.